to this webinar. This is a little bit about my background. I don't want to go into much detail of this, but basically it's about 41 years experience in the industry, in various industries. As Ringo mentioned, I'm working 13 years for SKF on asset management and asset reliability, helping customers to improve by doing assessments and benchmarking. Also did project management and program management for large projects. And one of the other roles was business development. Before I started with SKF, I worked 9 years with a company that developed the Maximo maintenance management system. Maybe you are familiar with that. And before that time, I had various positions in implementing ERP systems, supply chain management, warehouse, and logistics. So, but you can read that afterwards when you get the recording of this session. So the topic of today is rotating equipment performance, in an abbreviation REP. What is it? Well, actually, it is not something that SKF wants to sell. It's something that our customers ask for. They want this from us because the value proposition can bring one or more of the following benefits for the customers. It's about improving output. It's about reducing total cost of ownership, gaining insights to your machinery and how it performs. It's about improved safety and reduced impact on the environment. And we will go through those elements step by step. First of all, when we, for instance, take a look at total cost of ownership, what we see in the industry and what we see in plants is, first of all, you have to deal with cost of capital, which is often the spares, inventory, and then you have to deal with the cost for maintenance, repair and operations, which we call MRO. And those costs, they fluctuate. So they are not stable. So it's sometimes a different scenario to deal with. And then, of course, also, there are losses in production from overall equipment effectiveness. And that also varies. So when you look at the total cost for the customer, this is the total cost that the customer has. And basically, it's a kind of unstable annual cost and production losses. And actually, that's not really what you want. So when we look at REP, rotating equipment performance, what can we then deliver? Where can we help you? So first of all, we have business models. And one of the business models is rotation for life. So we will give you, let's say, rotation of your equipment in a fixed monthly fee. So it can be a long-term contract. So it's really a partnership, which is important. It has agreed SKF solutions with performance-based KPIs. So we are measuring key performance indicators. So you can measure also what is the impact of such a contract. And the benefit is also it avoids needs for CapEx because you can run this from your OPEX. And there is a reduced total cost of capital. So because of this, you have a stable and reduced overall MRO spend due to improved asset reliability. So you don't have all those fluctuations anymore. You also have reduced production losses. And our target with our customers is zero unplanned mechanical downtime. Can you imagine that? I have had many customers that said, Egon, this is impossible. But we are running contracts, long-term contracts with our customer, where this is not only the goal, but we also reach this, zero unplanned mechanical downtime. And when you look at this case, there is in total a lower cumulative cost for the customer. And there are more stable costs. So the predicted total cost of ownership is much less than you saw in the previous picture. So this is where the savings are. So now we also need to look at, okay, but how can we realize this? So when we talk about rotating equipment performance, we also talk about asset management. It is managing your assets. And when we take a look at that, first of all, we look at shareholder value. And we spoke about total cost of ownership. So we talk about cost. We talk about improving output. And we have to ensure compliance. So when we look at the shareholder value tree, there are basically those three elements. The cost, improving the output, and ensuring compliance. And when we take a look at reducing the cost, there are three elements. It's like operations, so the production cost. So what you want to have is improved volumes, improved yields, maintenance cost. So you want to reduce the maintenance cost, and we look at resources like energy. And when we reduce that cost, that has the impact on the shareholder value. The other element is improving the output, and output is often measured as OEE, overall equipment effectiveness. And there are three elements. It's availability, performance or speed, and quality. So you can imagine when we reduce unplanned downtime, we can make the machines more available. When the machines are more available, you can produce more, you can sell more, and you have more profit. So it's obvious that there is an increase in shareholder value. The other elements are performance and quality. And what's important here is to also to understand how you measure OEE. When we talk with customers, we get a variation of how it is measured, but it's important to understand. And of course, we need to ensure compliance. And we took the example here for a food company where we have food safety. That is their number one driver when it comes to compliance. But we also need to take a look at human safety and environment. Human safety is extremely important. That is why you have a sign in your plant. When you enter the plant, you see so many days working without accidents. So safety is important. And there is the relationship between unplanned downtime and safety. When there are a lot of breakdowns, typically the maintenance people are in a hurry to fix the problem because production is yelling at them, and then they ignore safety rules. So there is a relationship between the maintenance and the safety. And typically what you see is when plants or when customers are in a more proactive maintenance mode, when they are avoiding failures, the safety risk is reduced by 9 times. So when you have a lot of breakdowns, you are, let's say, opposed to a lot of safety risks. So how does it look from a customer perspective? Because we are talking about value here. So let's take this example. This is a customer, and the customer has defined key performance indicators. This is what they are measuring, and it can be different in your plant. They also put a benchmark for themselves. So this is not an industry best practice. This is a benchmark that they put for themselves. So for each KPI, they say, this is where we want to be. And you can see for safety, it's zero incidents. That's the target. And then you can also see the actual figures. So let's take a look at, for instance, maintenance cost per ton. This customer is producing 12 million tons. Their benchmark is 5.3. The actual figure is 5.67, which means there is a value gap of 4.4. If they move based on the 12 million tons from 5.67 to 5.3, they reduce their cost by 4.4 million. And now this has a big impact. When we look, for instance, at technical availability, the benchmark that this customer set for themselves is 98.5%. They are at 96.9. If they close this gap, they would produce 192,000 tons more, which is improved output. It has a revenue and it has a profit, so it has an impact on the shareholder value. But this is how we should look at those look at those elements to discover what is really the value, what is the value proposition. So now let's ask the question, do you know where you are going? You have a business plan in your plant, and so you know this is our direction, and every department has to deal with this. So we know where we are going, it's like a flight path. But then during the year, you get questions. We need to reduce the time to market. We need to increase productivity. We need to decrease maintenance costs. All those questions are basically a little bit destroying your flight path. They are destroying what you wanted to do. And the only way to anticipate on those questions is by having meters, by knowing what you are doing. When you don't have those meters, when you don't have those KPIs in place, and you then you're basically flying in the blind. And that is a dangerous situation. Look at what happened to a lot of companies during this crisis. No one expected this. So we had fantastic business plans. We knew about the market. And now suddenly this crisis comes and we have to anticipate on that. So we have to do things in a different way and we have to do it fast. So it's better that you know what to measure. And there are a lot of elements that has to do, of course, with cost. When you need to decrease your maintenance cost, well, you better know why you have the current cost, because maybe you need the money. If you don't know what your current cost is and you don't know why you need this maintenance budget, well, one thing is for sure, it will be cut. So when we look at overall equipment effectiveness and total cost of ownership, we see clearly that world-class companies, they have a high overall equipment effectiveness and a low total cost of ownership. And this is a little bit of a contradiction, because many people and many companies, they think that to have a high OEE, you need to have high cost. Well, it's not true. It's simply that world-class companies have the high OEE and the low total cost of ownership. And you can see here different areas. So you have to understand, am I in firefighting? So do I have, is my behavior purely responding? And what I have is a lot of breakdowns. So my reward is overtime heroes, people that are working continuously to fix problems. Or am I a little bit better? Am I trying to avoid failures? My behavior is doing a little bit of planning, so I have less surprises. Or am I in promoting? So my driver is uptime. My behavior is I have a disciplined organization and I have a competitive advantage. And of course, in innovating, you look at growth, you have organized learning, and you become world class. The whole idea behind this is also there is always room for improvement. So even when you are in world class, there is room for improvement. Because when you don't continuously improve, the competition might become better. So then you have to do all the work that you have done again. So how does SKF look at asset management? We have a model which we call the Asset Efficiency Optimization Model, AEO. And it has 5 building blocks. First block is a strategy. We all start with a strategy. So do you know why you do what you are doing? When you know that, can you turn that strategy into practice? So when we have that practicality, we need to plan it. So can you do what you should do well? That's the control section. When we have everything under control, we need to do work. Did you do the right work right? This is extremely important, because what we see in general in the industry, a lot of companies are doing the wrong work right. And sometimes the right work is done wrong. Doing the wrong work wrong, well, I don't have to explain that, what a disaster that can be. And then the next building block is, do you learn and improve? So it's optimization. And you can see this is a circle. It's a continuous process, so it never stops. When we look into a little bit more detail of those elements, we see the 5 building blocks again. So strategy, identification, control, execution, and optimization. So what does it mean? Do you know why you do what you do? Do you have a strategy in place? And what you see here is business goals. All the maintenance, all the asset management that you do has to be related to the business goals. So based on those goals, and they may differ from year to year, you need to think about your maintenance strategy. You need to think about what type of maintenance do I need to do now that my business goal has changed. So that is why it is also a continuous journey. So when we have that maintenance strategy, we are going to identify what type of maintenance are we going to execute. Is it preventive maintenance? Is it proactive? Is it involving operators? Is it run to failure? And of course, sometimes we have predefined the priorities. So the legal requirements, they determine what the priorities are. Legal requirements, they don't care about your business goals. Sometimes you have to inspect every 2 years. Well, the government and the legal authorities, they don't care about your business goals. You simply have to do that. So also when you have reliability issues and design, you can start a maintenance project to see what is the best maintenance that I can do. So all those strategies, they result in tasks. So that's the next building block. So we have a strategy, so we know what we need to do and why we do the maintenance. So now we need to identify. So can you turn a strategy into practice? So for operator-driven reliability, so involving operators who are doing tasks, they are doing data collection, or proactive reliability maintenance, you get a lot of information, but you need to analyze that. And based on the analysis, you need to make decisions. And based on those decisions, maybe you have to create work orders. From all the other tasks that you have, they are also put into work orders. This is the ideal world. And it's we all don't live in an ideal world. So sometimes something happens in your plant. So operators see things. So when they see something, they can create a notification, which can be a work order. Corrective maintenance. Sometimes things fail and we need to correct them. That sits in the work order. So this is where your maintenance management system starts. Your CMMS systems like Maximo, like SAP, DataStream. All those systems start with this, they start with the work orders. So now that we have everything in the work orders in our system, now we need to start doing some planning. So can you do what you should do well? So when we talk about planning, it's important to understand, do we have the spare parts? So spare parts need to be aligned. Do we have standard job plans and procedures so that we know for a certain job, it takes so much time? Because when we know that timing and we know all the tasks that we need to do, then we can start doing proper planning. And once we have the plan in place, we can start thinking about scheduling. Scheduling is about when are we going to do the job? And who is going to do the job? That's the control section. So now we have the job and we give it to the people to execute. So did you do the right work right? So first of all, when we execute the work, we need to make sure that we have the right tools, that we have the right people, the right training to perform the job. And when the job is finished, we need to do post-maintenance testing. Because what we don't want is do a job and come back a week later again to fix it again. Sometimes because of the pressure of production, we did a quick fix. Well, quick fixes cost a lot of money. It's often 5 times more expensive than doing preventive maintenance jobs. And then we need to update the living program. We need to update the maintenance management system with how many hours did we spend on the job? Which tools did we use? Which spare parts did we really use? Maybe we used subcontractors. But also, what was the failure mode of a failure? What was the cause of the failure? All that information needs to be fed back to the maintenance management system. So we can start thinking about optimization. So do you learn and improve? So maybe we need to do technology upgrades or machine upgrades. And we need to do root cause failure analysis. So that's easy when something breaks down, which is critical. Then it's easy to start thinking about, okay, what should we do different? And what type of maintenance should we put in place to avoid that failure next time? That's easy. But sometimes we have way too much maintenance because we are doing too frequently, we are doing measurements. Maybe we take too frequent vibration readings. So we need to think about that. So if we have a maintenance task that we need to do every month and in 2 or 3 years nothing happens, maybe the interval is wrong. So we can optimize the maintenance task and then we can optimize the cost, of course. And we need to look at our balance scorecard. So how well are we doing? And all that information from the optimization needs to be feedback to the strategy area. Not directly into the CMMS system. It needs to go back into the strategy area because this is where we have the reasons why we do the maintenance. And that's important. So how do we know what your situation is or can be? Do you know your situation? So basically, it's about identifying what are your needs. And to identify the needs, we have a benchmarking service which I will show you. Let's first look at this arrow again, the world-class arrow. So now you have to ask the question for yourself, where am I? Where am I on this on this arrow? Am I in stabilizing, in firefighting, or am I world class? Or am I promoting? It's important to understand because, well, 99.8% of all the customers that I talk with, they want to be world class. They want to be best in class. They want to be better than the competition. Well, if you want to be there, but you don't know where you are, it's extremely difficult to find a program that leads you to world class. It's like climbing the Mount Everest without knowing, am I in base camp or am I already in camp 4? Well, if you don't know, this whole mission is going to be a failure. So it's important to understand where you are. And maybe when you ask this question for yourself during this session, maybe you have one element in mind. Maybe you think about, oh, my OEE could be better, or my availability is not so good, so, or my maintenance cost is too high, or I have too much breakdowns. So then you are looking from a perspective of one certain element. And again, there is always room for improvement. So what is the benchmarking service? Well, the benchmarking process indicates key areas on which to focus and where it helps to achieve maximum return on your investment. So when we do an assessment, we look at what is your positioning? Where are you situated? Are you in maintaining or are you in innovating? You get a spider diagram that shows you the industry average, and I will come back to that later, and it shows you where you are, and it gives you a view on where are you in your industry? How well are you positioned against peers in your industry? So this is information that you get so you can start making the plan. Basically, when you have one thing in mind where you think you are positioned, we have 40 KPIs, 40 key performance indicators, 40 questions that gives the overall picture. So maybe you are very good in strategy, but you are not so good in planning and execution. All those questions, all those KPIs, they will give you the right information about where you are. And when you look at those questions, you can see them in the different areas, like the strategy, identification, control, execution, and optimization. Those KPIs, you can find them in industry norms. So it's not something that SKF developed. But we took 40 key performance indicators out of about more than 200 to get, let's say, a right picture and build the right picture for you. Also, what's important to understand is best practice percentages for industries are not developed by SKF. There are other companies that are doing investigations, they do reviews, they define what the best practice is. The only thing that SKF does, we look at the industry best practice. Because we have done more than 1,800 assessments, so we have a lot of data that we can use. So we can use, if you look at this example, this is the chemical, plastics and rubber industry. This is the industry average for that industry. So now it's important for you to understand, am I world class? So that's the outer ring. Or if I'm not world class, am I still better than the industry average? Because it's important, because you would like to have a competitive advantage. And I took this picture for this industry. But when I take all the industries separately, they all more or less have the same spider diagram. Most companies, they are lacking a strategy. Their availability could be improved. Planning is generally poor. Execution of the work is generally poor. Training of the people is something that is very underestimated. So it doesn't matter in which industry you are. Most of the time you have a picture like this. There are actually two industries that are, of course, doing better. And one of the industries is aerospace and the other one is the nuclear industry. So they have a different diagram. So when we do an assessment, how do results look like? So what could you expect from such an assessment to identify your needs, to identify the gaps? First of all, we have the spider diagram. And in this picture, you see the green line. This is where the customer is situated. So you can see a number of areas, they are on best practice level, but also areas where they are, let's say, far below industry average. Industry average is the dotted blue line. So you see every question, you see best in class, then you see the 75%, and you see the firefighting area. So this is important to understand. It gives you an overall picture. And what you see from this picture is a lot of spikes. And ideally, you have it more balanced. What you also get is traffic lights. So for maintenance strategy, you get a traffic light. So you see 10 questions, 10 KPI, you see the industry best practice, and you see the results in a traffic light. Red, yellow, and green. Green is obviously best in class. Yellow is 75%, and all the rest we consider as in the firefighting area. So that's where there is the biggest room for improvement. You get the same for identification, the same for control, execution, and optimization. So you can see it's all related to that asset efficiency optimization model. And here again, you see the 40 questions. After each traffic light, you get recommendations. Because when you have a traffic light that shows a few elements that are in the red, probably there are recommendations that can help you moving from red to yellow and from yellow to green. You also get a positioning, an overall positioning based on the 40 areas, 40 KPIs. So this client was somewhere in promoting. Also, what you get are business cases, because it's important, because we are talking about value, so we need to identify what is the money, what is in it for you. When you do all those projects, what can you gain? When we look, for instance, at spare part management optimization, in this example, the store's value of the customer was 14.7 million, which is 3.2% of the equipment replacement value of 446 million. Equipment replacement value is the value, the money that you need to build the plant. So imagine the plant burns down. This is how much you need to bring to build the plant again. Well, actually what you see here is the best practice is 0.3%. So 0.3% of that 446 million is 1.3 million. So this is what the customer should actually have. And they have 14.7. If they would go to 1%, then still the opportunity on spare parts would be 10 million euros. When we look at reduce unplanned breakdowns, the estimated unplanned breakdowns they had was 12,000 in a year, on average 1 hour. So they are losing 12,840 hours on breakdowns. They make 92 units per hour. So the implication is they lost production of 1.1 million units. The cost of no production is 64 euro. So you can see the impact of this. So if you would reduce the breakdown by 50%, they could produce 590,000 units more. And in this case, also those units could be sold. So they are losing revenue and they are losing profit. Also, two people typically work on a breakdown. So that means that also your maintenance cost will be reduced if you reduce the number of breakdowns. And now you can have those people working on serious jobs, serious preventive maintenance jobs. So this is how we build business cases. So, and the more information we gather, the more information you are willing to give to us, the more detailed the business cases can be. Then what we have is improvement recommendations. As I showed you with the traffic light, after each traffic light, we have recommendations. So for this customer, we had 13 recommendations. It's about an asset management awareness training for management. So now the whole organization understands what asset management means. When you look at ISO 55000, it's all about managing. So it's about the organization. It's the line of sight. So the whole organization needs to understand what asset management means. So in this case, that was a recommendation. Also, of course, the same training for people on the shop floor. Why are we doing this? Another one was spare part management, setting up a proactive reliability maintenance program, performing a maintenance strategy review. The customer had maintenance tasks, but they didn't know why they needed the tasks. The tasks came from OEM recommendations. So it's a general task. They also needed to improve KPIs. They had issues with planning and scheduling, and they had to start using Maximo for the full work order process. So they only took bits and pieces from their maintenance management system. So what we then do together with you is, from all those recommendations, we do a workshop. And the first one is, do you agree with the recommendation? So we don't talk about who is going to do the job. We don't talk about how much it's going to cost. We don't talk about resources that are needed. The only thing is, do we really agree with such a recommendation? So then we get a list. And in this case, the customer said, no, number 10, I don't agree. The other ones, I agree. Then the next step is about prioritization. So you prioritize what is important for you. Which ones are high, which ones are medium, and which ones are low. So this is how we go through the list. Then, based on the prioritization, we do a ranking. So we take all the highs, and then we say, okay, what is the ranking? Which one do we really want to do first, and which one do we want to do second? So that's important, because with this, we create a roadmap for the next 3 to 5 years. So it's important to understand what is the flow. And for this customer, they said, okay, this is our roadmap. So they publish the roadmap, so everyone in the organization knows, okay, what are we going to do and why are we doing this? So it's not something that SKF tells you what you should do. It's something that you realize what you should be doing to become world class. So to move from where you are on the path to world class. So that is how we create that roadmap. So how does such a process look like? Well, we have two options. We have on-site and we have remote through video conferencing. And this second option, you can imagine, was put in place because of the coronavirus that we have. So we cannot visit the plants. So we needed to think about, okay, can we do this remotely? And yes, we can. Of course, it's not always ideal, but we can do this remotely to help you understanding what are my needs. How well am I doing my asset management? How well is my equipment performing? And that's important, because when you know, then you can make a next step. So how do they look like? First, the on-site process is first of all an introduction presentation like we are doing now. Then there is a preparation interview, because you have to be prepared. The better you are prepared, the better the assessment process will be to identify your needs. So on day one, when we are on site, we do an introduction to senior management, because we want their buy-in. They need to understand what's happening. Then we do interviews and we do a plant tour. On day two, we develop the presentation. And on day three, we present the results and we do the workshop to the senior management and the interview team. And it's about a 4-hour exercise. So you can see in a very, very short time, we identify how you can improve. We have done this more than 1,800 times with customers in various industries. So what do you get then from this results presentation? Well, first of all, you get gaps between where you are and best in class. And of course, you can also see the gap with industry average. You get recommendations for improvements. We agree on the proposed improvements. Then you do priority setting and the ranking of the priorities. And that all builds your roadmap for the next 3 to 5 years. That's the on-site process. Now the off-site process, so the remote assessment, is again the same first steps, but even more focus on the preparation, because we are going to do this via video conferencing. So the preparation really needs to be very, very, very good and very, very detailed. Then we do the introduction of 1 hour and we do interviews again. And it is in 2 blocks of 2 hours because a lot of people, they cannot sit in front of the monitor for 8 hours having an interview. And it's not about those 40 questions. Basically, the whole interview is about the 40 answers that you give. And based on your answers, we dig deeper. So the more prepared you are, the more detail we can get. So when we have the 40 questions for building the spider diagram, that in the whole process, maybe we will ask you 200 questions or 250 questions and ask for evidence. Then on the second day, we do another workshop, the same workshop with the interviews, and that's another 2 blocks of 2 hours. And of course, we are flexible because it all depends on you, how flexible you are. If you want to do this 6 hours and 6 hours, it's fine with us. But then on day 3, we develop the presentation, and on day 4, we do again the presentation and the workshop. And we do that through video conferencing. So the whole presentation goes also through video conferencing. And then we can still do the workshop to identify the gaps, to agree on the proposed improvements, priority setting, ranking of the priorities, and then again, of course, the roadmap development. And all of this leads to those business models. So when we understand the value that's in there for you, then we can start building solutions for you that helps you increasing the performance of your rotating equipment in a long-term partnership, because you can see all of those recommendations. Well, you cannot do 10 or 15 or 20 recommendations at the same time. You need to build that roadmap for that. One is for information to your people, because your people you don't want to inform your people like, okay, now we are doing this, next week we are going to do this. Okay, and then suddenly after 6 months you say, oh, now we are going to do this. Your people get puzzled. And you don't want your people puzzled. You want to have a clear path for them as well, so they know how you are going to run your business in the next years and how that improves from maybe firefighting into close to world class. So this is about this presentation, about how we can develop your needs, how we can help you structuring a rotating equipment performance contract. So now the session is open for questions and answers. And I cannot see the chat box. So.
Hi, Egon.
Yep.
No, for now, I don't see any questions either in the chat box. Please take your time if you want to you ask something to Egon. Of course, you can also ask questions afterwards.
Yeah.
There's always a possibility, of course. We will share the contact details with all of you. And there's always a possibility, of course, to contact Egon directly. And we will also show you some detailed information about your contact persons in the UK. You see it here. I mean, for the different areas, we have different contact persons. Those phone numbers and data will be shared with you afterwards in the handouts. So, but please feel free to ask your questions if you want to. Okay, now, so Egon, if there are no more questions for the moment, I would like to thank you very much for your time and your explanation about the REP concept. I hope that people will be interested and get in touch with us for more information, especially, of course, for helping their rotating equipment moving even smoother in the future. And we can help you with that. Yeah. Finally, I will ask you to pay some attention to our next webinars, who are on the planning for the upcoming month. We have some on new developments. For example, the Bearing Assist app we will launch next Tuesday. This is a new app for the application engineering where you can help yourself by finding the right bearings and the right applications and the right tools to mount and dismount it. We have some interesting webinars coming up on the sealing solutions, on spherical roller bearings, but also on the smart industry solutions, looking at the industrial Internet of Things with condition monitoring. And the final one will be on the 7th of July with mounting and dismounting of bearings, preventing preliminary bearing failure. Okay, you will receive the recordings and the handouts as promised later today. There you can find also the link to our knowledge webinar program, where you can sign up for webinars in the upcoming weeks. Okay, Egon, again, thank you very, very much for your time and for your clear explanation. You receive numerous compliments in the chat box now for your great presentation.
Thank you.
And okay. Yeah. Thank you very much for everyone for attending, for joining this webinar. Hope you keep safe and have a nice day. And hopefully we will meet again in one of the upcoming webinars. Thank you very much. And hope to meet you next time. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.